Let's close our eyes for prayer.
Almighty God, we thank you very much for today. Thank you for your children, and not only your children, but your servants. We're praying, O Lord, as you used your servants in the Old Testament and New Testament, you'll use your servants today in Jesus' name. We're looking forward to the time we'll be able to give testimonies like these things we're hearing, and we'll know that it's having impact and working in our lives. We pray that none of us will be exempted from the mighty works of God in this period, in Jesus' name. Keep on leading us. Teach us your word again today. Open our eyes to see deep things hidden in your word for our benefit and for the benefit of your children that we are leading and teaching. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Already we have gone through chapters 1, 2, and 3 of the book of Joshua. And in the last study, we saw the children of Israel passing River Jordan, and they clean passed over. Today, we're looking at what happened after they passed over. The Lord gave them instruction that they will raise up stones of memorial or monuments, so that will remind them every time they saw the pile of stones, what the Lord had done for them. And when their children saw that, and they asked questions, what is the meaning or the significance of these stones piled up on this side of Jordan and also inside Jordan? They'll be able to tell their children what the Lord did for them. And so today we are tackling the subject, significant memorials of God's supernatural act. As you read chapter 4, you'll discover there were two piles of stones they were to set up as they crossed Jordan. One on the bank of the Canaan side of the river, and the other in the midst of Jordan itself, which could only be seen when Jordan went down, maybe during their dry season, the normal season. They were memorials or monuments of remembrance. They were to serve as a constant remembrance or reminder of God's power, who performed the mighty miracle of dividing River Jordan for them to walk through and to come into the promised land. You will notice this wasn't the first time they had the river divided for them. The Red Sea was divided for them. But at that time, they were not told to raise any monument or memorial of stones. Why? Because they were not expected to go back to Egypt, and they were not expected to make their tent at the Red Sea. And their children will never be there to ask any question, what is the meaning of this? But now, the wilderness was behind them. They passed over River Jordan. And then, as they lived in Canaan, their children will see the pile of stones. And they'll be asking them the question, what is the meaning of this? Then they'll be able to tell their children what the Lord did for them. It teaches us a very great lesson, that God wants us to always remember the things he has done for us. That's why he raises up memorials. And as you look at the Bible, you see quite a number of memorials or monuments. You understand, as you look at the word of God, that in Genesis, God gave Abraham the right of circumcision. It was to be a memorial, a symbol, a token, that every time that was done, it will remind Abraham of the covenant he had with him. You remember that the Lord gave unto Noah, that every time he saw the rainbow, he will know that God has set up a memorial, that every time he saw that, he will no more wipe out the world with a flood. And then you remember the memorial of the Passover. Every time the children of Israel commemorated the Passover, they remember how they were delivered from the land of Egypt. And then when they took manna, he told them they'll keep a part of that in the pot. They'll keep that for years from generation to generation. What's the meaning of that? So that they'll remember how the Lord fed them in the wilderness. And then Aaron's rod was there. So they'll remember that God had made a covenant with Aaron and his children, his descendants. They'll be in the high priestly line for them. And then in 1 Samuel chapter 7, they were to raise up a memorial to you. They call that Ebenezer, so that they will know hitherto as the Lord helped us. Look at it in 1 Samuel chapter 7 verse 12. Then Samuel took a stone, a
and set it between Mizpah and Shen, and called the name of it Ebenezer, saying, Hitherto has the Lord helped us. And it's about that kind of memorial, the help of the Lord, the mercy of the Lord, the goodness of the Lord, the miracle working power of the Lord, to be kept in remembrance. We're now reading about in chapter 4. We're dividing the study into three parts. Number one, indestructible monuments for the Christian's edification. Number two, indefatigable ministers, our constant exhortation. And then in number three, instructive memorials for children's education. We go to number one, instructible monuments for the Christian's edification. We're reading from Joshua chapter 4, from verse 1. And it came to pass, when all the people were clean, passed over Jordan, that the Lord spake unto Joshua, saying, in verse 2, take you 12 men out of the people, out of every tribe, a man, and command ye them, saying, take you hence out of the midst of Jordan, out of the place where the priest's feet stood firm, 12 stones, and ye shall carry them over with you, and leave them in the lodging place where ye shall lodge this night. Then Joshua called the 12 men whom he had prepared of the children of Israel, out of every tribe a man. And Joshua said unto them, pass over before the ark of the Lord your God into the midst of Jordan, and take you up every man of you a stone upon a shoulder, according unto the number of the tribes of the children of Israel, that this may be a sign. That's a memorial, that's a monument, that it may be a sign among you, that when your children ask their fathers in time to come, saying, what mean ye by these stones? Then ye shall answer them, that the waters of Jordan were cut off before the ark of the covenant of the Lord, when it passed over Jordan. That is, when the ark passed over Jordan, the waters of Jordan were cut off, and these stones shall be for a memorial unto the children of Israel forever. Which means the pile of stones, they will pile up eventually outside Jordan. It will not just be a temporary thing, it will be a sign. It will be a memorial to the children of Israel forever, from generation to generation. And then in verse 8, and the children of Israel did so as Joshua commanded, and took up 12 stones out of the midst of Jordan, as the Lord spake unto Joshua, according to the number of the tribes of the children of Israel, and carried them over with them unto the place where they lodged, and laid them down there. And Joshua set up 12 stones in the midst of Jordan, in the place where the feet of the priest which bear the ark of the covenant stood, and they are there unto this day. Now we have read over in those 9 verses how the Lord instructed Joshua. And Joshua was to instruct 12 men out of all the 12 tribes, and they were to take big stones. We know they are big stones because they are told to carry those stones on their shoulders. And then they will set the 12 in the place where they were to set the 12 stones. And then Joshua himself, he went into the river. And then inside the river itself, he set the 12 stones there as a pile for them to remember. The question is, why were they to set the stones inside? So that the children will know, whenever they saw the pile of stones shooting out, they will know that somebody must have been inside there, and then they will be convinced that the river was divided. All that trouble was necessary so that they'll be able to preserve for generations to come the miracle working power of God, that those who are not there will be able to know that of a surety and certainty the Lord had performed that miracle for them. But why was all that necessary? I told you it's a memorial, a monument, and it is for remembrance. You see, they were not all people that could read. Therefore, when they saw those pictorial things, then they will be asking questions, and then the history that is preserved for them will be told unto them. Actually, the children of Israel, they are the peculiar problem. The peculiar problem, and I think we have the same problems too, is the problem of forgetting the work of the Lord. And the Lord wanted to do something definite so that they will not be as forgetful as they had been. They will remember the word of the Lord. In Psalm 78, Psalm 78, reading there from verse 7, it says that they might set their hope in God and not forget the works of God, but keep his commandments. That's what the Lord was doing. He was setting that memorial for them, giving them commandment to set up those stones so that it will be a constant reminder for them that they will never forget the works of the Lord, the miracles of the Lord, the great things he did for their forefathers, so that they'll be able to believe that that same God that did that for their fathers is able to do that for them as well. Unfortunately, the children of Israel, they kept on forgetting. Because in this Psalm 78, we're told over and over again, instead of remembering, they forgot. Look at verse 11. In verse 11 it said, and they forgot his works and his wonders that he had showed them. And then it goes on, relating a lot of those things that he had done for them. And yet, later again it says, they soon forgot what the Lord had done for them. In verse 42, they remembered not his hand, nor the day when he delivered them from the enemy. It was exactly the opposite that the Lord wanted. He didn't want them to be forgetting so soon like that. He wanted them to keep in mind the miracle working power of God. We owe to ourselves too to remember all the benefits of the Lord. As he saved us, a great miracle. Has he given us sanctification? A marvelous miracle. Are we baptized in the Holy Ghost? A great miracle. Have we been healed and delivered? A great miracle. What has the Lord done in our midst? We should keep them in remembrance, because the recollection of them will do a lot of things in our lives. Number one, it will be inspiration. When you become depressed, if you are weak, if you are depressed, if you are discouraged, a recollection of the miracle power of God, of the things he has done for you in the past, of the testimonies you have heard, will awaken you and put life into you and encourage you again, so that you will know the same God that did that before is able to do that again. Number two, the recollection, remembrance of those things will give us a joyous sense of being loved. We will know that the love of God had done that for us, and that same love of God that did that for us in the past, he can do that once again. Number three, it purifies the soul with gratitude. You become grateful to the Lord. You sing unto the Lord. You count your blessings one by one, and you see what the Lord has done for you. Number four, it binds us by the sweetest bonds of love, of the cord of love, to the service of the Lord. It will make you to say, if the Lord has done that for me, what then can I do for the Lord? He gave himself for me. He worked miracles in my life. He did that in my family. It's been so wonderful to me. What then can I do for the Lord? Number five, it also brightens the future with the radiance that which at once is most trustworthy. It brightens your future. The God of the past is the God of today, and he is the God of the future. Number six, it moves us on in our pilgrimage, trusting God and taking courage. Then you understand that the monument was not of clay, because if it were of clay, the rain could easily wash everything away, but it was of stone, so that it will be an enduring kind of monument that endured unto many generations. All through the generations of the children of Israel, the pile of stones remained there and inspired them by the memory of them, blessed memory of the things the Lord has done for them. How about the church today? Is there anything the Lord has given us as a memorial, so that when we see those things, there'll be a recollection of what Jesus did for us on the cross of Calvary? Not only that, there will be the hope within us. He did that in the past, and we're looking forward to the future when he will come again, because he promised he will come again. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, 1 Corinthians chapter 11, what he has given us now as a church, as a memorial. 1 Corinthians 11, verse 23. In 1 Corinthians 11, from verse 23, it tells us, for I have received of the Lord that which I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. It's a kind of memorial for you to recollect what the Lord has done. It says, when you take that bread, you are remembering the death of the Lord. It says, take this, you do it in remembrance of me, because it's like a symbol for the body that have been broken for you. And then we're told in verse 25, and after the same manner also, he took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do as often as ye drink it in remembrance of me. And then in verse 26, for as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death until he come. You know what the memorial does? Number one, it makes you to look back what you did in the past. And then number two, it makes you to look forward. And then it says, until he comes. It's coming again. The very fact that we're celebrating the Lord's Supper, and we should be celebrating that very regularly, will be reminding us that Christ came before and Christ is coming again to take us unto himself. Then we go to point number two. Point number two, we're looking at indefatigable ministers, our constant exhortation. We're looking at Joshua chapter 4 now, from verse 4 to verse 18. Joshua chapter 4, from verse 10 to verse 18. Joshua chapter 4, from verse 10. For the priests which bear the ark stood in the midst of Jordan until everything was finished that the Lord commanded Joshua to speak unto the people, according to all that Moses commanded Joshua, and the people hasted and passed over. I want you to notice all these verses as we read, even though it's a long passage. We're Bible believers, and this is a Bible church, and it says that all scripture is given by inspiration of God, and we shouldn't be so much in a hurry. We cannot read the scriptures as the scripture is written. In fact, it's only that I didn't want to break the chapter itself, because I'm looking forward to getting to chapter 24. I read through, I listened in cassette, and then I talked to myself, if I break chapter 4 to 3 studies, then I wondered it will take me more than a year before I finish 24 chapters. That's why we're bringing everything into one study, but there's quite a lot in every chapter. Please take note of all that we're reading in every verse. The people hasted and passed over. I have a lot to say about that. And then in verse 11, it says, it came to pass when all the people were clean passed over, that the ark of the Lord passed over, and the priests and the presence of the people, and the children of Reuben and the children of Gad, and of the tribe of Manasseh passed over, and before the children of Israel, as Moses spake unto them, about 40,000 prepared for war passed over before the Lord unto battle, unto the place of Jericho. On that day the Lord magnified Joshua in the sight of all Israel, and they feared him, they honored him, they respected, reverenced him, as they feared and respected Moses all the days of his life. And the Lord spake unto Joshua, saying, command the priests that bear the ark of the testimony, that they come up out of Jordan. And Joshua therefore commanded the priests, saying, come ye up out of Jordan. And it came to pass, when the priests that bear the ark of the covenant of the Lord were come up out of the midst of Jordan, and the soles of the priests' feet were lifted up unto the dry land, that the waters of Jordan returned unto their place and flowed over all its banks as they did before. Those are the verses we're looking at now, and we're talking about these ministers, these priests. There's an adjective that describes them, and the adjective is indefatigable. I don't know whether you know what that means. You know the word fatigue. When you are fatigued, you are tired. And when you are indefatigable, it means you are tireless. And the dictionary puts it as never giving up and never stopping. Even when you appear tired, when it appears you are weary, you still keep on doing what you ought to do. I want you to understand the position and the place that these priests that they occupied, a place of honor, On the one hand, it was a place of honor. Why do we say that? Because as soon as their feet stepped on Jordan, then Jordan was divided. So they were the instruments of God in performing a great miracle. But you understand, it was a place of danger. Because while they were there, and they were carrying the ark, it was a sacred thing. You remember what happened later to Uzzah when he touched the ark of the Lord? If they were carrying the ark, if they did anything wrong while they were standing there, the Lord could strike them dead, or the water could come over them and just sweep them all away. Therefore, it was both a place of honor and a place of danger. That shows the life and the ministry of the minister. The minister has a place of honor. A place of honor because of the great things God will do through us. A place of honor because we are the people that God is using. River Jordan is divided so that the people of God can pass over onto the promised land. We are the instruments of God to make a way for the people to come out of the wilderness of the world and get into the heaven of Canaan land. That's a place of honor. That's a ministry that brings respect and honor. And when they call you a leader, they call you a minister, or whatever title they call you, it's a great thing, but it's a place of danger too. Because if we compromise, because if we just take our initiative and we do what we shouldn't have done and see Jordan heaped up, that could come upon us as the wrath of God and the judgment of God anytime. So you understand the two sides of the position of the place that you occupy. Honor on the one hand and then danger on the other hand. But then it says they were indefatigable. Do you realize the number of the children of Israel? They ran into millions. And all the millions of them, they were moving on. You know the time it takes us here before we all move out. It takes some time. And see these priests that were standing there without getting tired. And they were carrying the ark of the Lord. And they did that until every young one, every man, every woman passed over River Jordan. That shows that those ministers, they were trustworthy people. They were faithful people. They were uncompromising people. And they were dedicated people. They were loyal people that stood at the point of duty at their post, even when all those people were passing over. And so then those priests, they teach us a lesson of implicit obedience. As the Lord giving us his work to do, as he shown us how to do it, as he told us where to stand, and as he told us how to stand there and how long we should stand there, implicit obedience to the commandments and instruction of the Lord. Not only that, they teach us patient fortitude. They were enduring and they were very patient as they were there. And that is a lesson for you and for me, not in the work of the Lord. While the people of God are passing over and we have to stand at the point of duty, we'll remain patient in the Lord. But then we also understand, it showed their faith and their courage. As a Lord, the Lord will call us to do. And without faith, without courage, it cannot be done. It will not be done. It shows uncompromising fidelity. Fidelity, faithfulness, they are the same. And they were uncompromising in their faithfulness. They're always looking up to the Lord. The Lord told us to be here. The Lord told us to do this. The heap of water is there. Whatever may happen is watching over us. He knows we have to stand here until all these children of Israel pass over, and therefore will remain the way he wants us to remain. But there's something challenging here. And I want you to look at verse 15. In verse 15, the Lord spake unto Joshua, saying, command the priests that bear the ark of the testimony that they come up out of Jordan. Isn't it interesting? All the children of Israel had passed over now. Nobody remained. And they opened their eyes. They knew that the children of Israel, all of them, they were on this other side now. They were tired already. They have been standing there for a long time already. And the work is done already. Everybody is gone. And they kept on standing there. They will not even take their initiative. They will not take laws into their hands. They will not use what we call common sense. Common sense demands that we are here so that the people will pass over. Now the people have passed over. What do you think common sense is telling us? Common sense is telling us, move, get out of the place. You are tired already. God will understand. Joshua will understand. Nobody will blame you for it. But he kept on standing there until the Lord said unto Joshua that Joshua should tell them,
It's all right now. You've been patient, you've been obedient, you've been faithful, you've been loyal. You've shown that you are ministers and priests, that you are worth your salt. Therefore, you can come out of the place now. Then in verse 17, Joshua therefore commanded the priest, saying, come ye up out of Jordan. Wonderful that the people had passed over and they were still remaining there. Do we do the work of God like that? Do we give the extra time it demands? Do we give the extra effort that it demands? Even when we think everything is done, now do we resort back to our common sense and say that common sense demands that this is the step we ought to take now? That's the reason we're learning from this book of Joshua, that as those people demonstrated tirelessness in the work of God, they demonstrated that indefatigable kind of characteristic, the same thing we should be learning from the Lord, that with you we should demonstrate, so that whatever we are told to do, we are faithful to the Lord, we are loyal to the Lord, and we remain at the point of duty until the Spirit of God will use the leader he has appointed over us, saying, now you can move. We have to be very careful that the spirit of the world, you know, the spirit of the world and the spirit of the age. The spirit of the age is, you do what you like to do at the time you like to do it, and as long as you want to do it. And when you feel you are tired, you don't wait for any leader to tell you, come out of the place, you are tired now, that's enough now. We take laws into our hands, and then we move when we have not been told to move. That's why we're learning. If God gave these people the grace of God, and they were able to stay like that without being tired, by the grace of God, all these lessons we're going to learn, they will be in our lives, and we will carry them out like they did, and the blessings of God will be upon us as well, in Jesus' name. Now, we're coming back to verse 10. I told you that there's something there that we need to talk about. It says in verse 10, for the priests which bear the ark stood in the midst of Jordan until everything was finished that the Lord commanded Joshua to speak unto the people, according to all that Moses commanded Joshua. Here is the sentence now. And the people hasted, and the people hasted, and the people hasted and passed over. What do you think of that? The people were very considerate. They knew the slower we are to move over and to cross over to the other side, the more strain we're going to put on the people of God, on the ministers, on the priests that are standing in the midst of Jordan, in consideration for them, so that they will not stand a minute longer, an hour longer than they ought to stand. The people in that kind of consideration, they hasted. Isn't that the way we should consider our ministers? You should be very considerate. We have a pastor there. You should be very considerate. We have some leaders over there. If we don't do this in time, if we don't do it this way, if we don't do it this way, it is not considerate. That shows that the people had a heart of unity. Well, those ministers that were standing there, actually it means they were walking hand in hand. They're standing there, we are walking over. The faster we walk over, the easier it will be for them, and then they'll be able to leave that place, will not be an extra burden unto them. But it's another lesson. These people we're talking about, the people of Israel, they had been in the wilderness for 40 years. How eager they were. And they have been learning about the land of Canaan, the land that is flowing with milk and honey. They have been dreaming about it. They have been thinking about it. And now this was the only obstacle, the river dividing them from the wilderness to the land of Canaan. And the eagerness in them, I want to see that Canaan land. I want my feet to be on that Canaan land, the promised land that our forefathers are not able to get into. They remembered their fathers that bleed their bones in the wilderness, that died in the wilderness. And they say, think about it, that I am privileged and you are privileged, and we're going to move over. Because of that, they were so much in a hurry, and they hasted and passed over. Have you been born again? And you have been hearing there is something called sanctification, the fullness of the love of God coming into the heart of man, and God doing a divine operation in your heart, and the ministers are standing there and they are proclaiming that sanctification. You will not be slow, you will be so eager,
and you'll be so much in a hurry, you will haste and pass over unto the land of Canaan. Have you been sanctified? Now you are going to be faithful, because I'm going to ask you a question, and you are going to, you know, show by raising up your hand, and you must be faithful in this, because if you tell me a lie, you will try to find me, and because you will make restitution. And you know it's very difficult. You'll be lining up on Tuesday. You'll be lining up for 4 Tuesdays before you are able to see me to make that restitution. I told you that so that you can be faithful. Now, how many of us have not been baptized in the Holy Ghost? Can you raise up your hand? Can you stand up? You are not baptized in the Holy Ghost yet. If you are sitting down, you'll come and apologize later, and you are going to line up for a long time. It will take a longer time than what we are having here now before you are able to see me to do that. You have not been baptized in the Holy Ghost. Can you stand up? Thank you. You keep on standing. We're talking about the promised land. And the promised land is like the land of Canaan. Actually, the land of Canaan symbolizes a lot of things as we look at the scriptures. Because a lot of things in the Old Testament, they typify, they symbolize a lot of experiences in the life of the believer. For example, the crossing of the Red Sea, that symbolizes our redemption, our salvation, our forgiveness, our coming out of the world, believing on the Lord Jesus Christ, because Christ is our Passover. Crossing the Red Sea, that symbolizes our water baptism. That is, they were baptized unto Moses in the Red Sea. And after we are born again, which is symbolized by our coming out of Egypt, we are baptized in water. When the Lord brought them to Sinai, he wanted to write the law upon their heart. That symbolizes our sanctification. Now this event now, crossing Jordan, passing over very quickly into the promised land, it symbolizes the baptism in the Holy Ghost. And it says the people, they hurried up. They were so eager because of the land flowing with milk and honey. They wanted to be there in time. And they hurried up and they made haste and they passed over unto the land of promise. And their feet stepped on the land of promise. When we get into chapter 5, you are going to see some marvelous, marvelous things. And you are going to see one of the reasons why they passed over. A lot of things change from chapter 5 on through. It's like a remarkable kind of event that changed everything. When the Holy Ghost comes upon you, you've been saved, you're coming back now from all those other places, you've been walking through the wilderness after your salvation, a lot of things happened. You murmured in the wilderness, what shall we eat in the wilderness, what shall we drink in the wilderness, why is the journey so long, but you are born again in the wilderness, how is it only this Moses going to lead us all the complete, but you are born again, you are in the wilderness. Eventually the Lord says, let me write the law in your heart, and then he sanctifies you. He says, no, but it's not sufficient. You need power, because you see the Canaanites over there. There is a ministry the Lord has committed into your hand. And all those kings of the Canaanites, they're going to be coming like a confederacy against you. You need the power. You will receive power when the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you'll be witnesses unto me in Jerusalem and in Judea unto the uttermost part of the earth. What are you doing? Why don't you hurry up and move on so that that baptism will come upon you? Tonight you are going to receive in Jesus' name. Because all it needs to do is for the priest to stand there with the representation of Christ, carrying the ark, and then say, people of God, move over. And then you are eager, you consecrate, you are eager, you pray, you are eager, you have a great desire, you are eager, you are hungry, you are eager, and say, yes, Lord, I want to pass over, and you'll pass over unto Canaan land. Those of you who are standing, how many of you will pray and receive tonight? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. And those of us who are sitting down, please sit down. All those of us who are sitting down, you have been filled before, there will be a renewed in filling again in Jesus' name. And so they were very eager and they passed on unto Canaan land. Let me show you some other scriptures, because it says that these ministers, they were not tired. They remained there until the people passed over. We're looking at 2 Samuel chapter 23 and in verse 10. 2 Samuel chapter 23 verse 10. It says here, this is the example for you. Illustration, exhortation for you. And it says, he rose and smote the Philistines until his hands was weary and his hand cleared to the sword, and the Lord wrought a great victory that day, and the people returned after him only to spoil. We're told here that he was weary, but his hand cleared to the sword. That means that although those ministers were weary, Although they were tired, yet they kept on doing the things that they ought to do. It's an illustration for you and for me, exhortation for you and for me, that we should be diligent in the work of the Lord, and we should not allow anything to hinder us, anything to make us tired, as we're involved in the work of the Lord. In Romans chapter 12, Romans chapter 12, reading there in verse 11, not slothful in business, indefatigable. You are tireless. You keep on walking. Although you are weary, but your hands cleave to the sword. Not slothful in business, fervent in spirit, serving the Lord. Fervent in spirit, serving the Lord. In Ecclesiastes chapter 9. Ecclesiastes chapter 9. What is in there in verse 10? It tells us the way we ought to take the work of the Lord. Whatsoever thy hand findeth to do, do it with thy might. For there is no work, nor device, nor knowledge, nor wisdom in the grave whither thou goest. I pray that what we have learned here, of the example of the lives of these people, these ministers that we have seen, it will be in our life as well, in Jesus' name. Now we go to point number 3. Instructive memorial for our children's education. The Lord was not only concerned about the present generation, he was concerned about the future generation. Go back to verse 6 again. It says that this may be a sign among you, that when your children ask their fathers in time to come, saying, what mean ye by these stones? Then ye shall answer them, that the waters of Jordan were cut off before the ark of the covenant of the Lord when it passed over Jordan. The waters of Jordan were cut off, and these stones shall be for a memorial unto the children of Israel. And then in verse 19 now, from verse 19, and the people came up out of Jordan on the 10th day of the first month, and encamped in Gilgal, in the east border of Jericho. And those 12 stones which they took out of Jordan did Joshua pitch in Gilgal. And he spake unto the children of Israel, saying, when your children shall ask their fathers in time to come, saying, what mean ye by these stones? That ye shall let your children know, saying, Israel came over this Jordan on dry land, for the Lord your God dried up the waters of Jordan from before you until ye were passed over, as the Lord your God did to the Red Sea, which he dried up from before us until we have gone over, that all the people of the earth, not only their children, not only the children of Israel, the memorials, the monuments they were setting up was to be a kind of lesson, instruction for them, that even the whole earth will know that the hand of the Lord, that it is mighty, that ye might fear the Lord your God forever. That ye might fear the Lord your God forever. What the Lord had done for them, they are to preserve unto their own children. And those stones as memorials will be serving as a reminder. And when the children, inquisitive children, will be asking them, what's the meaning of this? What's the significance of this? Then they'll be able to tell their children that this is the reason for it, and their children will believe the Lord. Their children will honor the Lord. Their children will follow the Lord. We're not only to give food and clothing to our children. We're not only to give education to our children in training their mind. We must make sure we develop them in the area of their morals and their spiritual needs as well. Because godliness is the best thing you can give to your children. The deepest impressions are often created in childhood. Because at that time, the clay is easily molded. At that time, the tree is still soft and tender, and you can bend it in any direction you want. Because at that time, if we look at their mind, at their heart, like a white sheet of paper, it may not be quite blank, but there is a lot of space left for the godly teaching of the word of God. That's why it's your responsibility that you will teach your children. Fathers and mothers, are we so busy that we're not able to teach our children? The word of God tells us we have to instruct our children in Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians chapter 6, reading from verse 4. It says, and ye fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. In the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. And then the mothers have their part too. In 2 Timothy chapter 1. 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 5. When I call to remembrance the unfeigned, unpretending faith that is in thee, which dwelt first in thy grandmother Lois and thy mother Eunice, and I'm persuaded also in thee. Chapter 3 and verse 15. Chapter 3 verse 15, that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. We have seen today the dividing of Jordan. But I told you that this dividing of Jordan has three things, principal things to lead us into. Number one is edification. Number two, exhortation. Number three, education. And while you see, to edify us, it's to edify us in the sense that Jordan was divided. And as Jordan was divided, the people of God, they moved over unto the land of promise. And I've told you that they were saved, they were the redeemed of the Lord, but then the Lord wanted to write the law in their heart, even though they declined when they were in Sinai. And yet eventually they came to this side, and the Lord eventually, he made them to pass over River Jordan. And I told you, it's symbolic of the baptism in the Holy Ghost. And the baptism in the Holy Ghost is very essential for a child of God. It's very essential for anyone that bears the vessel of the Lord, anyone that is doing the work of the Lord. Because without it, you lack the power, you lack the unction, you lack the authority, you lack the wherewithal where you can do the work of God effectively. In Matthew chapter 3 verse 11, I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance, but he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I'm not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. Here John the Baptist was saying, you see what I've done for you. He said, I baptize you with water. How was he able to baptize them with water? They came from their houses, they presented themselves before him, and then they surrendered themselves into the hands of John. He held on to them, they relaxed their muscles, they relaxed their body, he lowered them into the water, and they surrendered unto him. He lifted them up. He said, in the same way, there is one here mightier and greater than I. He will baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. How will you have that? You've gone to him for salvation, and then you go to him for sanctification. And after you are sanctified, you come to the Lord, you say, I need that power. I cannot move on with that power. I want to get into that land flowing with milk and honey. It is when you are baptized in the Holy Ghost, you get into that land of promise, you'll be able to engage all those powers in Canaan land. You'll be able to engage all those kings in their confederacy. And then the captain of the lost souls that you'll see in chapter 5 will be with you. Then you will destroy and demolish all the strongholds. But you must hold on to the promise of the Lord that says the baptism of the Holy Ghost is for you. How difficult is it for us to have that baptism in the Holy Ghost in Luke chapter 11. Luke chapter 11, I'm reading there from verse 9. And I say unto you, ask, and it shall be given you. Seek, and ye shall find. Knock, and it shall be opened unto you. For everyone that asketh, receiveth. And he that seeketh, findeth. And to him that knocketh, it shall be opened. If his son ask a bread of any of you, that say, Father, will he give him a stone? Or if he ask a fish, will he give him a serpent? Or if he ask for an egg, will he give him a scorpion? If ye then, being evil, know to give good gifts. And the Holy Ghost is a good gift. It will give you the power to pray. It will give you unction. It will give you anointing. It will give you authority. It will make the name of Jesus more dynamic in your mouth. It will reveal heavenly things to you. It's a gateway into the gifts of the Spirit, the word of knowledge and the word of wisdom and the gift of faith and the rest of it. It's a good gift of the Lord. How much more then? It says, if ye then, being evil, know to give good gifts to your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to them that ask him. Will he give you? I said, will he give you? The question is, how do we receive? Is it by working out something? In Galatians chapter 3. In Galatians chapter 3, reading from verse 14, that the blessing of Abraham might come upon the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through what? I said through what? Through faith, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. And that Holy Ghost is available for us today. If you have been saved, if you have been sanctified, and you are desirous, and you want that unction, and you want that power, you want that anointing upon your life, the Lord is able to do it today in Jesus' name. Acts of the Apostles chapter 1 and in verse 8. In Acts chapter 1 verse 8, let me begin from verse 4. And being assembled together with them, commanded that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which says, ye have heard of me, for John truly baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized. Ye shall be baptized. I said ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. But look at verse 6. When they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, when shall we be baptized in the Holy Ghost? They asked of him, saying, what kind of power, authority are we going to have when we are baptized in the Holy Ghost? No, Lord. Well, now at this time, restore thee again the kingdom to Israel. See the question they were asking. See what the Lord was talking about. You see, that's the attitude of many people. While River Jordan is divided and Joshua is pointing it out, everybody keep on moving now. It doesn't take any effort now. The river is open for you. The way is open for you. Move over to the land that is flowing with milk and honey. And those people hasted and they pass over. Some people have some irrelevant questions to ask instead of moving on to the land of Canaan. But Jesus said in verse 7, he said unto them, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father has put in his own hand, but ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria unto the uttermost part of the earth. It will happen to you today. I said it will happen to you today. If you are getting ready, can you stand up? Because when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. They were united in purpose. They were united in purity. They were united in their passion, in their desire. They were united in everything. The day of Pentecost came for them. And it says they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind. And it filled all the house where they were sitting. And they appeared unto them as is appearing to you now, cloven tongues like as of fire. It sat on each of them. And they were all filled. And they were all filled, and they were all immersed in the Spirit, and they were all baptized, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they began to speak with other tongues, and they began to speak with other tongues, and they began to speak with other tongues, as the Spirit gave them utterance. The promises unto you and to your children and to as many as the Lord our God shall call. The promise is unto you. The promise is unto you. The promise is unto you. And to all our children, as many as the Lord our God shall call. He has opened up River Jordan for us. He has opened up the way into Canaan land for us. He has opened up the way to move over into the land that is filled with milk and honey. When are you going to pass over? Do you have faith in God? Do you desire? Are you passionately asking the Lord, oh yes, fill me. Oh Lord, fill me. Oh Lord, baptize me. Oh Lord, immerse me in the Holy Ghost. If ye been evil, know to give good gifts unto your children. How much more? How much more readily? How much more willingly? How much more speedily will the Lord Almighty, the Heavenly Father, your Father which is in heaven, give the Holy Ghost to them that call on him, to them that believe, to them that ask him. You can ask the Lord now. You can ask the Lord now. The Holy Ghost will come. He will come with fire, purifying fire, saturating fire, empowering, energizing fire. He will baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. And then you'll move out to do the work of the Lord. You will move out to do the work of the Lord. You will move out with greater unction, greater authority, and greater power. River Jordan is divided. River Jordan is divided. The presence of Christ that is symbolized by the ark is here already. And the Lord is making his people pass over. Don't remain in the wilderness, children of God, people of God. Don't remain in the wilderness. You have been 4 years in the wilderness, 10 years in the wilderness, 40 years in the wilderness. Move on, and cross over unto the land that is flowing with milk and honey. Move on unto the land of power. Move on unto the land of plenty. Move on unto the land of the power of God. Move on unto the land of the gifts of the Spirit. You need the Spirit of God, the power of the Spirit, the fruit of the Spirit, the gifts of the Spirit, the word of wisdom, the word of knowledge. You need the gift of faith. You need discerning of spirit. You need the gifts of miracles. You need the gifts of healing. You need that dynamic dynamite of faith in your life. The speaking of diverse kinds of tongues, interpretation of tongues, and prophecy coming from the very heart of the Lord. Let the Spirit come upon me. Let the Spirit come upon me. Let the Spirit come upon me. Have you been saved? Have you been sanctified? Let the Holy Ghost come. Let the Holy Ghost come. Let Jesus take you. Surrender your body. Surrender your tongue. Surrender your life. Surrender everything to the Lord. Let him dip you, immerse you, and put you inside the Holy Ghost. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. You'll never be the same again. You'll never be the same again. When the Holy Ghost, when the power of the Holy Ghost came upon Samson, he was never the same again. When it came upon Elijah, he was never the same again. When it came upon Elisha, he was never the same again. When the Spirit comes upon you, you'll never be the same again. Surrender yourself unto the Lord. Let him baptize you. Let him immerse you into the Holy Ghost and move on into the land of Canaan. Move on into the land of promise. Move on into the land of power. Feel me. Feel me. Feel me. Feel me. And those of us who have been filled before, let him feel you again. Let him feel you again. Let him feel you again.
Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. Break me, melt me, mold me, fill me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. Break me, melt me, mold me, and fill me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. Break me, melt me, mold me, and fill me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me.
In Jesus' name we pray. In Jesus' name we pray.
And you put up your hands, whether you have received before or not. The Spirit of the Lord is here tonight. And that Spirit of the living God will fall fresh upon you. That Spirit will break you, will melt you, will mold you, will fill you to overflowing. You will move over to the Canaan land in Jesus' name. And all those powers that have been waiting for a long time, waiting to confront you, as you move over and pass over, and you move over in the power of the Lord, in the unction of the Lord, in the anointing of the Lord, with the power, baptismal power of the Holy Ghost in your life, with the gifts of the Spirit in your life, the very first thing you are going to find out, walls of Jericho will fall before you in Jesus' name. You will talk like a giant. You will walk like a giant. In every meeting you hold, in your district, or in a crusade, anything you do, the power of God will walk and move through you in Jesus' name. Can you sing that song with me? Spirit of the living God. Spirit of the living God. Sing it out. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Break me, break me, melt me, melt me, mold me, mold me, and fill me, fill me, Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Sing it again. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. Sing it out. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me, even me, break me, me, melt me, mold me, fill me, Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me once more. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Break me, melt me, mold me, fill me, Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. Almighty God will come to you now. We are your children. You have saved us. You have sanctified us. You have purified us. You have prepared us a habitation for Holy Ghost. And therefore, I pray for all my brothers. I pray for all my sisters. I pray for all the group coordinators. I pray for all the coordinators. I pray for all the women coordinators. I pray for all the women representatives. I pray for all the zonal leaders. I pray for all the sectional leaders. I pray for everyone here. I pray for the campus people. I pray for all those student representatives. Oh Lord, send your Spirit in Jesus' name. Upon every brother, upon every sister, pour out your Spirit in Jesus' name. According to your promise, which will never fail, that Jesus will baptize us with the Holy Ghost and with fire. I pray right now the fire of the Holy Ghost. the power of the Holy Ghost, the anointing of the Holy Ghost, the insight of the Holy Ghost, the gift of the Holy Ghost will come upon all your people in Jesus' name. The people that were baptized before and the fire is dying down, I pray that you make the fire again. Make the fire again. Make the fire again. Baptize them in fire in Jesus' name. Immerse them in the Holy Ghost. Immerse them with anointing. Immerse them with unction. Spirit of the living God, our hands are raised up. We surrender everything to you. We open our heart to you. Every brother here, every sister here, baptize them in Jesus' name. Let there be greater anointing. Let there be greater power. Let there be greater boldness. Let there be greater authority. I pray, O Lord, from now on, Jericho will fall before them in Jesus' name. I pray that impossibilities will be possible in Jesus' name. I pray, O Lord, your fire will be upon them. Your fire will be within them. Your fire will be around them. As they go back home, they will never be the same again in Jesus' name. I pray that the manifestation of the sign of the baptism in the Holy Ghost, speaking in a new tongue, in a new language, even now, give it unto them in Jesus' name. Confirm your word in every heart, in every life, right now, in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, for doing it. Thank you for answering our prayer.